My name is Adam Kokesh. I served as a sergeant on the Marine Corps Civil Affairs Team in the Fallujah area from February to September of 2004. And I actually volunteered to go to Iraq. I was a reservist in an artillery unit. And when I found out my unit was getting called up, I decided I didn't want to miss the party. So I found out that a civil affairs group at Camp Pendleton was looking for volunteers. And so I went out of my way to volunteer for that. And I was against the war before the war, even believing all of the lies that were told by Colin Powell at the UN, believing all of the intelligence, believing all the spin. I didn't think it was going to be worth it. But I thought that afterwards what we were doing was cleaning up our mess and really responsible foreign policy and genuinely trying to do good by the Iraqi people. And that was something I wanted to be a part of and something that I enthusiastically risked my life for. This is the rules of engagement card that I was issued for our deployment to Iraq. And this is held up as the gold standard of conduct in the occupation right now. I'll just read a part of it. It says, "Nothing on this card prevents you from using deadly force to defend yourself. Enemy military and paramilitary forces may be attacked subject to the following instructions. Positive identification is required prior to engagement. Positive identification is reasonable certainty," and that's in quotes on the card, "that your target is a legitimate military target." And of course, we're supposed to keep this in our breast pocket here. But when Marines are put in a situation where they receive fire and all they see is a muzzle flash coming from a building, and they don't have positive identification, but they know that if they return fire through that window or towards that building, that they're more likely to live through whatever's going on, it's a really difficult situation. And I think it's criminal to put such patriotic Americans who have sworn an oath to support and defend the Constitution of the United States of America in a situation where their morals are at odds with their survival instincts. During the siege of Fallujah, we changed rules of engagement more often than we changed our underwear. At first it was, you know, you follow the rules of engagement, you do what you're supposed to do, and then there were times when it was you can shoot any suspicious observer, so someone with binoculars and a cell phone was fair game. And that really opened things up to a lot of subjectivity. But also firing at muzzle flashes into the city, firing Mark 19s into the city became common practice. And at one point, we imposed a curfew on the city of Fallujah. And at that point, we were told we were allowed to shoot anything after dark. And fortunately, I was never put in that situation to make that decision. But there were a lot of Marines, you know, on the positions around me who were forced to make those choices. About the situation being criminal, about the criminality of putting Marines in this position, because when you tell them that the rules of engagement are you can shoot anything that moves after dark, we have a reasonable certainty based on our intelligence or whatever that anything that moves after dark is an enemy combatant. Well, you can't expect those Marines to stop and analyze every situation because they're going to operate based on those rules of engagement and they're going to do what they have to do. So I was got up in the middle of the night when the Iraqi policeman at our checkpoint got the call, and through pointing and pantomime and the little Arabic I spoke at the time and an Arabic translation dictionary, I was able to help figure out that there were Marines shooting at Iraqi firefighters and cops, and we were able to send it down our chain of command and stop that from happening. But you know, how many incidents like that happened where it wasn't so clear and there were just shadows that being shot at? And I know that, you know, that happened while I was there during the siege of Fallujah. That kind of thing where, you know, we're just, you know, harassing people unnecessarily is really kind of part of daily life there. And eventually we set up a proper checkpoint, and I was relieved and went back inside, and the Marines that were there were checking almost every car that came through, and they found a couple of guys that had a bag of cash in their back seat, and they detained them on suspicion, and we're like, all right, well, we're going to detain them and interrogate them. And so they were zip cuffed and hooded, and I was told to go out and get them and pick them up, and so I picked them up in my Humvee, got the bag of cash, brought them back to the office where it was air conditioned, and sat them down, and was just keeping an eye on them. And then the interrogators got there, and they were like, why the heck are you guys being so nice to these people? And they started roughing them up and throwing their heads against the wall and, you know, preparing them for interrogation. And they dragged them out of the office, and apparently they got actually reprimanded on the outside of the office by one of our officers for engaging in that unnecessary behavior. And then they interrogated them, and they found out that there was no reason to detain them any further. And the bag of cash was about this big, which would have been a lot of American money, but Iraqi dinars. It was only about $10,000-$15,000. And so they let him go, just like that. And I can tell you, if that money wasn't intended for the insurgency beforehand, it was after that.
My name is Jason Hurd. I recently completed 10 years of honorable service to my country in both the U.S. Army and the Tennessee National Guard. I served in central Baghdad from November of 04 to November of 05. I'm from a little place nestled in the mountains of East Tennessee called Kingsport. My father was adamantly opposed to me serving in the military. My father was one of the most warmongering, gun-loving people you could ever meet. But he didn't feel that way when it came to his son because he knew the negative psychological consequences of combat service. Looking back, I know for a fact that my father had post-traumatic stress disorder. He had the rage, he had the nightmares, and he had the flashbacks. I decided against my father's wishes to go into the military as a medic in August of 97. We got into Iraq in November of 04, and I was there until November of 05. I served as a medic with Troop F, 2nd Squadron, 278th Regimental Combat Team. After we finished the EOD escort missions, we moved on to another mission, patrolling the Kendi Street area, which is right outside of the Green Zone. Kendi Street is a relatively upscale neighborhood. Some of the houses in the Kendi area would cost well over $1 million here in America. This area, from what we were told, had no violent activity at all up until the point we started patrolling this area. I remember we were out on a patrol one day, a dismounted patrol, and we were walking by a woman's house. She was outside in her garden doing some work. We had our interpreter with us, and our interpreter threw up his hand and said, "Salam alaikum," which is their greeting in Iraq. It means peace of God be with you. And he translated back to us what she said. She said, "No, no peace of God be with you." She was angry and she was frustrated. And so we stopped and our interpreter said, "Well, what's the matter? Why are you so angry? We're here protecting you. We're here to ensure your safety." And that woman began to tell us a story. Just a few months prior to this, her husband had been shot and killed by a United States convoy because he got too close to their convoy. He was not an insurgent, he was not a terrorist, he was merely a working man trying to make a living for his family. A few weeks after this man died, the Special Forces team got some intelligence that this woman was supporting the insurgency. And so they conducted a raid on her home, zip-tied her and her two children, threw them on the floor, and I guess her son was old enough to be perceived as a possible threat, so they detained him and took him away. For the next 2 weeks, this woman had no idea whether her son was alive, dead, or worse. At the end of that 2 weeks, the Special Forces team rolled up, dropped her son off, and without so much as an apology, drove off. It turns out they had acted on bad intelligence. Ladies and gentlemen, things like that happen every day in Iraq. We are harassing these people, we are disrupting their lives. One day we were on another dismounted patrol through the Kendi Street area. We were walking past an area we called the Garden Center because it was literally a fenced off garden. As is policy, we were to keep all cars and individuals away from our formation. And so a car was approaching us from the front. I was at the rear of the formation because I was the medic, and the medics hang out at the back with the platoon sergeant in case anything happens up front so you can respond. They waved the car off down a side street so that it would not come near our formation. As I made it up to that side street, the car had turned around and was coming back towards us because the street was blocked off by a concrete T barrier at the other end. So I began doing my levels of aggression. I held up my hand, trying to get the car to stop. The car sped up. And I thought to myself, "Oh my God, this is it. This is someone who is trying to hurt us." And so instead of doing what I should have done according to policy and raising my weapon, instead I did what you should never do, and I took my hands off of my weapon altogether and began jumping up and down, waving my hands back and forth, trying to get this car to stop and see me. The car kept coming. And so I raised my weapon, and the car kept coming. I pulled my selector switch off of safe, and the car kept coming. I was applying pressure to my trigger, getting ready to fire on the vehicle, and out of nowhere, a man came off of the side of the road, flagged the car down, and got it to pull over. He walked around to the driver's side door, opened it up, and out popped an 80-year-old woman. Come to find out, this woman was a highly respected figure in the community, and I don't have a clue what would have happened had I opened fire on this woman. I would imagine a riot. Ladies and gentlemen, I hate guns. I spent 10 years in the military, and I carried two of them on my side in Iraq. But I think they should be melted down and turned into jewelry. To this day, that is the worst thing that I have ever done in my life. I am a peaceful person, but yet in Iraq, I drew down on an 80-year-old geriatric woman who could not see me because I was in front of a desert-colored building wearing desert-colored camouflage. Part of our mission was to meet and greet the local population and find out what their problems were. And so I approached a man with my interpreter on the side of the road, and I asked him, I said, look, are your lives better because we're here? Are you safer? Do you feel more secure? Do you feel like we are liberating you? And that man looked at me straight in the eye, and he said, Mister, we Iraqis know that you have good intentions here. But the fact of the matter is, before America invaded, we didn't have to worry about car bombs in our neighborhoods. We didn't have to worry about the safety of our own children as they walk to school. And we didn't have to worry about U.S. soldiers shooting at us as we drive up and down our own streets. Ladies and gentlemen, the suffering in Iraq is tearing that country apart. And ending that suffering begins with a complete and immediate withdrawal of all of our troops. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. My name is John Michael Turner. I currently reside in Burlington, Vermont. I served with Kilo Company, 3rd Battalion, 8th Marines as an automatic machine gunner. There's a term, once a Marine, always a Marine, but there's also the term, eat the apple, F the Corps. I don't work for you no more. I served 3 deployments with Kilo Company, 3rd Battalion, 8th Marines, one of which was in Haiti, the other 2 were in Iraq, in between Fallujah and Abu Ghraib the first time, and in downtown Ramadi at the government center the second time. On April 18th, 2006, I had my first confirmed kill. This man was innocent. I don't know his name. I called him the Fat Man. He was walking back to his house, and I shot him in front of his friend and his father. The first round didn't kill him after I had hit him up here in his neck area. And afterwards, he started screaming and looked right into my eyes. So I looked at my friend who I was on post with, and I said, well, I can't let that happen. So I took another shot and took him out. He was then carried away by the rest of his family. It took 7 people to carry his body away. We were all congratulated after we had our first kills, and that happened to have been mine. My company commander personally congratulated me, as he did everyone else in our company. This is the same individual who had stated that whoever gets their first kill by stabbing them to death will get a 4-day pass when we return from Iraq. There was one incident where we got into a firefight just south of the government center, about 2,000 meters. We had no idea where the fire was coming from, and the way our rules of engagement were, pinpoint where the fire is coming from and throw a rocket at it. So with that being said, we still didn't know where the fire was coming from. And an 84-millimeter rocket was shot into a house. I do not know if there was anyone in it. We do not know if that's where the fire was coming from, but that's what was done. This man right here was my 3rd confirmed kill. As you can see, he was riding his bicycle. Later on in the day, we went ahead, and we had CBS Laura Logan with us, but she was with the other squad. And so she wasn't with us. So myself and two other people went ahead and took out some individuals because we were excited about the firefight we had just gotten into, and we didn't have a cameraman or woman with us. With that being said, anytime we did have embedded reporters with us, our actions would change drastically. We never acted the same. We were always on key with everything, did everything by the books. The man on the bicycle, he was left in the street for about 10 minutes until we realized that we needed to leave where we were. And his body was dragged about 10 feet to the right of him, where his body was thrown behind a rock wall and his bicycle was thrown on top of him. On my wrist, there is Arabic for FU. I got that put in my wrist just 2 weeks before we went to Iraq because that was my choking hand. And anytime I felt the need to take out aggression, I would go ahead and use it. This is after one of the guys in a weapons company had gotten shot. This is a way that we would take out our aggression. It is illegal to shoot into a mosque unless you were taking fire from it. There was no fire that was taken from that mosque. It was shot into because we were angry. The reason I am doing this today is not only for myself and for the rest of society to hear, but it's for all those who can't be here to talk about the things that we went through, talk about the things that we did. With that being said, that is my testimony. I just want to say that I am sorry for the hate and destruction that I have inflicted on innocent people, and I'm sorry for the hate and destruction that others have inflicted on innocent people. At one point, it was okay, but reality has shown that it is not, and that this is happening, and that until people hear about what is going on with this war, it will continue to happen, and people will continue to die. I am sorry for the things that I did. I am no longer the monster that I once was. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Sam Lynch. I came in the Army in 1994 as an infantryman and did active duty for a little while. And in 1997, I became a conscientious objector. But I opted to stay in the military and transfer into medical services. After getting out of active duty, I went to the North Carolina National Guard, and I deployed with the North Carolina National Guard to Iraq from February 2004 until December 2004. So I think what I want to focus on during my time of talking is the medical response to the Iraqi people. Throughout the next 8 months, there were out of probably approximate 15 doctors in our clinic, there were three doctors that would go to see the detainees. So it became a situation where the medics did most of the medical care. And most of the things that were seen were headaches and backaches and things that could be treated rather easily with Tylenol or Motrin. But there were urinary tract infections, there were hernias, there were things that really did require a doctor's care. And when I confronted doctors with it, in at least four cases, four different doctors responded that we're not going to see them because they're not American. Some specific instances, there was a individual who had blood clots in his lower legs, and it was a fear that a blood clot would loosen itself and become lodged and cause a stroke. So we had him on Lovenox shots twice a day to cut out the blood clots, and I had to. At this time, it was right when this operation was starting, so I was still going through and getting doctor's signatures on prescriptions. And depending on who the doctor on duty was, depended on whether or not this person would get his medication or not. Towards the end of the rotation, it got to the point where the medical personnel were writing the prescription. Not the doctors, but the medics themselves were prescribing medicine for the detainees because nobody else would do it. Going into the detainee center, when we did a initial assessment of all the detainees, there was a tendency for the MPs who ran the detainee center to want to identify the detainees by what they were being arrested for. And so instead of it being an individual, they lost their name, they became a number, and it became 30-0024, for example, try to bomb U.S. soldiers, or is targeting translators. Really, they lost their identity in that process, and it was really hard to maintain a unbiased attitude towards caring for them when the first thing you hear about them is what they're there for. But as it turns out, there was a high percentage of the people who were detained that were just released because there was not enough evidence on. And I don't have an exact number, but during the time that I was supervisor, we saw approximately 225 detainees, and I would say that at least 60 or 70% never had enough evidence on. This medical neglect actually started to transcribe out into the other elements of Iraqi people, the Iraqi workers on the post. They would be doing construction work and have an injury, and they would be refused treatment. The translators, there was a translator who I worked with quite often who developed a hip problem and tried to get him an x-ray, and the doctors refused treatment on him. There was just a lot of neglect, and it's a situation that I felt at the time that I should have said something, and I didn't. And being in charge, I feel a lot of guilt because I didn't say anything at the time, and I really feel that I did an injustice to these people by not demanding that the doctors actually see them, and instead trying to do the doctor's job, me and the other medics on our own. And I believe that's all I have.
Good morning. My name is Mike Tott, and I served with the 716th MP Battalion in the 101st Airborne. I was deployed to Iraq in April of 2003 and returned home in April of 2004. At one point in the deployment, when I was on a convoy just north of Baghdad, we pulled over to have an MRE refuel our trucks. And it was about a six-vehicle convoy. Oftentimes, the kids in the surrounding community would run up to us and say thank you, and be very welcome us with warm arms. And we didn't want that kind of attention from the kids for fear of their safety, because we knew we were a targeted audience in that country. This one incident, a kid was trying to cross a four-lane median highway and was struck by a vehicle going about 65. A number of us ran over there. I hopped in my truck and ran to stop traffic. A number of us, including my sergeant major, ran over there. And by the time he was walking back to his truck, which was about 30 seconds after he looked at the kid, said, "He's gone. Move out." And I wondered to myself, what would have happened if this was an American kid who was just struck? Pre-deployment, the cultural competency training that we received can be best summed up in a sentence. Don't touch the people of Iraq's left hand. They wipe their ass with it. And that's what we got. The Iraqi policemen, we were, okay, our mission was in part to run a jail in Karbala, not for enemy prisoners of war, but just for the general population prison. These prisoners would be brought into the, by the Iraqi police, and then we were to show them through the processing and how we do things in America. We weren't in charge necessarily of enemy prisoners of war, but on the night of October 17th in 2003, six people were brought in by the Iraqi police who claimed that these six were participants in the actions the night prior. Therefore, they were enemy prisoners of war due to coalition standards. When these people were brought in, they were appeared to be beaten already badly. They were lined up on the concrete wall, and they interlaced, we told them to interlace their fingers, which is a form of control, because you can grab your middle finger and your index finger and squeeze them together, and it's quite painful. Interlace their fingers, place their foreheads on the concrete wall, cross your ankles, and put your hands on top of your head so we can search you and process you in. They were tagged, they were searched, and they were also beaten. Not just by Americans, but by Bulgarian soldiers and by Polish soldiers, by Iraqi policemen, and by me. I grabbed the man by the jaw and I looked him in the eye and I slammed his head up against the wall and I looked him again in the eye and said, "You must have been the one that killed Grilly." And then he fell, I kicked him. An Iraqi policeman, probably the size of the biggest security man here, with hands to match the size of a Kodiak, hit a guy in the side of the head about six times, and I thought to myself, I'm looking at him and I laughed, I'm like, yeah, these guys are getting what they deserve. I never found out whether or not this all took place also in the presence of a lieutenant, my lieutenant, within earshot of many NCOs. I never found out what happened to these people, these six prisoners. I don't know whether they, where they went. I don't know anything about that. And I'm up here today to speak on behalf of all the people who haven't returned home, who can't speak. This isn't just some isolated incident. This happened in the presence of NCOs, commissioned officers, and coalition forces, not only as participants, but also as witnesses. My being up here displays my anger, both by on multiple levels, by the Americans' behavior overseas, by our president's continuous rhetoric about Iraq being a success, about this country's citizens and apathy to this occupation, and this is why I'm here today as well. These events happen in our name, and each and every single one of you are responsible for this as well. I am very sorry for my actions, and I can't take back what I did. I ask the forgiveness of the people of Iraq and of my country, and I will not enable this any further. General Petraeus, you may not remember me, but you once led me. You're no longer a leader of men. You've exploited your troops for your own gain and have become just another cheerleader for this occupation policy. So you pinned this on me in Babylon in 2003 following the October 16th incident. I will no longer be a puppet for your personal gain and for your political career. Thank you.
طبعا اليوم اتاحت لي الفرصة على مود احكي لكم الوضع صار بيه من بغداد والوضع الامني وش صار بي يعني وشون تأثرت يعني بمواضيع يعني. بيوم من الأيام كنت بالمدرسة طبعاً دوامنا صبحي فكنا دا ندرس ها فعلى غفلة طبوا الأمريكان طبعاً وطلعونا برا فقالوا يعني على أساس أكو أسلحة أو إرهابية يعني بالمدرسة ها فطلعونا برا وقعدوا يدورون وبعثروا المدرسة وطلعونا برا ويعني إحنا طبعاً أطفال كنا ونخاف من هيك مواضيع يعني وأسلحة وهيك وأذرعة وهاي يعني فكنا كلش خايفين وأني طبعاً بالخامس وياي أختي كانت فكلش خفت يعني صارت عندي حالة يعني من كل شيء أخاف من كل شيء يصير أخاف طبعاً أني طموحة وكل الزينة بالدراسة طبعاً ردت دائماً أكون يعني أحسن يعني فرد صالح من المجتمع طبعاً وأحقق على الأقل حلم واحد يعني من أحلامي اللي أنا دا أفكر بيها وأحقق أحلام كل طفل عراقي اللي شاف مثل مأساة اللي شفتها طبعاً واللي شافوها زميلاتي بالمدرسة وتأثروا بيها طبعاً أمي شافت هيك وضع وأبوي شاف هيك وضع خلوني أقعد عن المدرسة وما أداوم فيعني هذا كلش أجعز يعني ضجت كلش من هذا الوضع فطبعاً اضطروا لأنه الوضع الأمني كان أبد مو زين الأمان ماكو على غفلة يفوتون الأمريكان على غفلة ميليشيا تفوت علينا يعني نحن ما نريد حياتنا إحنا ها فأمي قالت نقعدهم طبعاً ضاعت علي يعني دراستي ويعني دائماً كنت طموحة وأريد أتقدم وأحلامي أحققها بس مع الأسف ما خلوني أمارس يعني أحلمي وأحققه من سبب هاي الوضع الأمني ببغداد والقتل والعنف والإرهاب وكل شيء مسيطرين علينا كل شيء ما نقدر ناخذ رأي يعني ياخذون رأينا طبعا أتمنى لكل عراقي يعني ويعني كعمري أنا همينة عراقية وكل قد عمري وأكبر كل العراقيين يحققون أحلامهم طبعا ويروح العنف
Hi, good morning. Thank you all for being here. I'd like to thank Lisa Kentu and Jen Hogg, without whom I would not be on this panel. And thank you all for being here. I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself. I trained as a combat medic. I joined straight out of high school. I was 17. My first experience with sexual harassment was with my recruiter. He was married and his wife was pregnant. And he used to make it a requirement for me to like go with him and like talk to other soldiers about joining the army and kind of like reeling them in, you know? And so like that was one thing. And then one night he got drunk and he had to stay at a hotel because his wife was mad at him or something. And he had me drive him to the hotel and at the hotel, he came on to me and I was able to like kind of weasel my way out of it and get out. That was my first brush with just the military and kind of sexual harassment. When I was in basic, drill sergeants were known to sleep with the trainees. I did not personally witness it or was it on me, but they were known. When I deployed, I was in a clinic. I worked sick call. I was a combat medic. And so I had this interest for working in, you know, for looking at gruesome things because I wanted to see the good stuff, you know. And I asked one of the surgeons that was there, I said, hey, is there a way that I can go to the operating room and watch a case? He's like, okay. Next day he came and he's like, do you want to start working there? I was like, yeah, sure. I started the next day at 7 o'clock in the morning. And through that whole deployment, I was harassed like every single day. I dreaded every day I went to work because this person would catch me alone or like catch me in a hallway and like push himself against me with his hands behind his back. And I can tell you it's extremely difficult to do your job proficiently, efficiently, and correctly when there's someone that you have to look out for, your own people, your own, you know, your own comrades, your own supervisors. So basically what he was practicing was quid quo pro. You know, I transferred you to the operating room, so therefore you need to give me something back. It never got to a physical point because he knew exactly what he was doing, and I never reported it because it was just, I knew command wasn't going to do anything about it, so there was no point. This person wasn't a person of a very extremely important position, and he had transferred me over, and all I kept thinking about was, if I speak out, it's going to be my word against him, and I'm just an E4, I'm a specialist. So who are they going to believe? Are they going to get rid of the guy that's making all the decisions and saving lives, or me, the disposable specialist? You know, and a lot of people say, why didn't you report it? You know, it's so easy. No, it's not. You know, you're looked at as a snitch for turning around and talking about your brothers and sisters and comrade, you know, and comrades that you're working with day in and day out. I joined trying to do something for my country, and I joined, you know, trying to be patriotic. And the last thing I would have imagined would have been joining an organization where by my own peers, by my own comrades, I would have been harassed in that way. Thank you very much.
This war has cost us many things, most of all the lives of our precious children. It has cost us the lives of Iraqi people, thousands and thousands. We paid for this war in many ways. We paid for this war in lost jobs and services that billions of dollars of our money, that billions of our money could have created. The funds that went to war were no longer available to meet our needs at home. Instead of serving the common good, as government should, the Bush administration, with the support of Congress, took our country to an illegal war. They did so over the objections of the world community. They did so in violation of international law and our treaty obligations. In 2007, the decision to go to war cost us $137 billion. There are many things that we could have done with $137 billion in 2007. Hired 2 million music and art teachers, or paid scholarships to 22 million college students, or built 13,000 new elementary schools, or placed 18 million children in a Head Start program, or hired 2 million elementary school teachers, shipping containers, windmills, doctors, nurses, and houses. With $130 billion, we could have hired 2 million port container inspectors. We could have hired 3 million public safety officers, or built 1 million affordable housing units, or provided health care for 39 million adults and children. This occupation also cost the American people $720 million a day, or $500,000 every minute of every day. According to the American Friends Service Committee, this figure is averaged daily, total for the real and present future cost of the war. So far, Congress has appropriated more than $560 billion for this war. When you add up to all the real costs, including lifelong medical care for injured veterans, plus interest on a huge debt created by the war, placement of military equipment, and other future costs, the war and occupation have a price tag of over $1 trillion in the first 4 years. In this slide, you see the devastation of Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans. So when Hurricane Katrina and Rita hit, emergency equipment and the forces to operate it were sitting in Iraq, unavailable for rescue and reconstruction in Louisiana, Mississippi. Funds needed to rebuild areas devastated by hurricanes were lining the pockets of Blackwater and corporations like Kellogg Root and Brown and giant corporations like Halliburton. The war created 4 million Iraqi refugees. It also turned out hundreds and thousands of Americans into refugees in their own country. 3 years after the devastation of Katrina, most of the people displaced by Katrina are still living in trailers or with relatives all over the country. In this slide, you see children. What has the war cost us? Health and well-being of our children. For the cost of $1 a day of occupation, we could provide 400 children with health care, or more than a million with free school lunches for a year. 46 million of us go without health care, and thousands of poor children are being pushed off the federally funded SHIFT program. Between 2002 and 2006, dozens of federal programs were cut. Programs like Head Start, community food and nutrition programs, youth and job training, affordable housing, materials and child health care programs. 37 million of us were poor in 2005. Today, 37 million of us are poor. Thank you very much.
And I need to show the Iraqi families, the American ordinary people, no support the invasion, no support the war. And like Iraqi people lost the member in the family, American people lost the member in the war. I have a opportunity to meet with the families in Iraq, lost 2, 3, 4, 5 members in the same time. And these people opened the door and opened the heart and give me a beautiful welcome. When my son died, I put very crazy. Carlos entering the fire. I have the other reaction. I have a grandson. Jesus have a baby. Only 16 months old. Everybody crying in the house. And my baby watched the everybody and no understand what happened and cry. And I got my grandson and go to the park and play with him for his smile. I don't have opportunity for cry for my son. I don't have opportunity because the government told me your son died with the shot on the head. It's impossible you see the body. We not pay the funeral for you because you chose the civil cemetery. It's impossible you see the body because the face is destroyed and it's not good for the family. Morley, I understand the military system of the government lied me. My son not died when they received the shot on the head. Jesus died when I stepped the illegal American cluster bomb. I'm waiting for 2 hours for medical assistance and died. He no have opportunity. I miss my son. I cry every single day for Jesus. It's 5 years. The next 27 is 5 years my son died in Iraq. But when I come in here today with Iraq Veterans Against the War, and I see Camilo, and I see Juan, and I see Jeffer, I see Jesus. This is my new family. This is my boys. My sons and my daughters is here in Iraq Veterans Against the War. But this is only the one story. Carlos is the other story, 2 stories here. We have almost 4,000 stories today. 5 years. How many more stories you need? And how many more blood need the American people for to stand up with the Iraq Veterans Against the War, with the families, and say, bring the troops home now? How many more years?
My name is Zoli Peter Goodman, formerly known as Petty Officer Goodman, United States Navy, V-1 Division, Air Department, USS John F. Kennedy, CV-67, HUA. The war ends every single day for our soldiers because someone is discharged from the United States military every single day. They're discharged with no assistance into the VA system. Some people are discharged without knowing that they qualify for veterans benefits like I was. Many people are told to join the military that you will receive health care, your family will receive health care, your dependents will receive health care, and no one can take that health care away from you. September 2005, I was on a training operation deployed out of Jacksonville, Florida. We were underway. My wife was pregnant with my unborn child. While I was on that training operation, my wife began the horrible process of a miscarriage. Being home by herself, the first thing she did was call the TRICARE hotline. TRICARE is the healthcare service that's provided to us in the military. The lady on the hotline told her that she probably already had lost her child and that there was nothing they could do. She asked for an ambulance, and she was told that if she had $1,500, they were willing to send an ambulance. Not having $1,500 on the salary of an E-4, she chose not to get the ambulance. And she called a friend of mine and waited for him to come pick her up at our apartment and drove her to base. There's a hospital on Naval Station Mayport. It's called the hospital at Naval Station Mayport. And she arrived there at 4 p.m. She went inside, and the nurse told her that they were closing at 4:30 and they couldn't help her. She insisted to see a doctor. The doctor told her that they could not help her, and she was turned away. And she once again waited in the parking lot while she was bleeding for my friend to take her to another hospital 23 miles away called the hospital NAS Jacksonville. No ambulance was provided, nothing, no assistance, and we lost the child. She sent a Red Cross message to me on the ship. Upon receiving the Red Cross message, I requested to take leave. I went home on leave with no assistance, no plane ticket. The money that I did spend on a plane ticket to get home left me in a very hard position with a wife who needed health care that I could not provide for her, and neither could my government, apparently. Later on after that incident, I was discharged with no access to the VA, no assistance with help into the VA. Finally finding out that I qualified for veterans health care, I found the application online, filled it out, and sent it in to be processed. The processing of this application took several months. I don't know how many because I lost track of time, but it was at least three. Upon requesting mental health and mental help over the phone, I was told that I could not get an appointment for 3 months, and I did not make an appointment. A few days later, I looked up the law, and the law says that the VA only has a 30-day maximum to provide an appointment for someone requesting an appointment. So I called this wonderful organization back, and I cited the laws of our wonderful country, and I was given an appointment, and like every other appointment that I've ever had from the Veterans Administration, it was 30 days later. So after going through this process, the first thing they tried to do was medicate me. No therapy was recommended, medications were recommended. They gave me three different medications. The first was trazodone, the second was Paxil, and the third was gabapentin, a generic form of Neuron. My doctor did not give me any information on these medications. He told me that PTSD treatment is not a science, that there is no science to it, and that you can mix and match these medications and something may work for you that doesn't work for another vet. So I left my appointment that day and I went home and I did research on the medications that I was given. And I found out that the main side effect of all three medications is suicidal thoughts and suicidal tendencies. And that's disgusting. So now I get to go to a 15-minute therapy session once every 30 days. And when I show up to my 15-minute therapy session, there's 15 other Vietnam vets that have the same 8 a.m. appointment that I do, and we all wait around in the lobby. Every single one of these vets is there seeking help and treatment for the same thing that I'm seeking help and treatment for, and they're all 30 years older than I am. They've been in the system 30 years longer. They've been taking the same medications for 30 years, the same therapists for 30 years, and they're still there, and they still have the same problem. So obviously, it doesn't work. 10,000 Iraq war vets have committed suicide. My name is Zoli Peter Goodman. I'm a proud warrior and a prouder patriot, and that's my problem with the VA.
Hello, everyone. My name is Eric Stenzo, and I was in the United States Marine Corps Reserves from 1999 to 2005. I was with 4th Light Armored Reconnaissance Battalion. I did one tour in Iraq in March 2003 and ended in September of 2003. I was activated for a year, and I also did in the reserves what we call active duty special work. So I've essentially done 2 years worth of active duty with the United States Marine Corps Reserves. And while I was in country, within the final 3 weeks of tour in country, I had a non-combat injury, and I was told by our battalion aid station officers that if I tell anyone that I had my back injury in country, that I would stay in country or I'd go to Germany, which would be in my best interest to not say anything until we get back to Camp Pendleton. So I thought that that was guidance from people who know what they're doing, so I figured that that would be the best thing to do. So I waited, injured, without my command even knowing that I was injured, and not even my platoon sergeant at the time, and I was a Lance Corporal when I was out there, that I had a back injury. And again, you know, this is about trusting the guidance that I received from people who knew what they were doing. So I went back to Camp Pendleton and immediately sought care with the Navy Medical Center, and their response was actually outstanding. It was the day that I reported my back injury that it was the next day that I was actually seen. And I was getting therapy, and I thought that this was great. I served my country, and I did my tour in Iraq, and I'm being taken care of. So I then got out of the military and became a full-time student, and enrolled in Los Angeles, oh, it was Long Beach VA healthcare system. And that's where I began to see the realities of what it truly means to be in the VA healthcare system. And I did leave the military with $17,000 saved, good credit. I was a good Marine, and I served honorably. I never questioned anything about the integrity of my service to country, and the services that I was receiving until I went into the VA healthcare system. And it was then that some things were just not working out for me. So the $17,000 that I saved went to zero, expenses built to such an extent that they were overwhelming and I couldn't pay it anymore. So I ended up sleeping in my car for one day. I was in Hollywood. There was a food wagon that was serving free food to homeless people. And I decided to take that opportunity to eat some free food. And at first I was thinking, I'm just hungry and this is free food and I'm gonna go for it. So I looked at myself and I started thinking to myself that I'm now an Iraq war vet. I'm standing in a line with homeless people being served free food, and this is actually happening to me. This is actually happening to our Iraq era war vets, and that I'm one of them, and I'm a casualty of that system. And at that moment in time, the reality hit, and it hit so hard that suicidal thoughts began. I broke down several times. I literally cracked the day after that. I lost dignity, self-respect. My honor just went down, and I was in a very dark place for a considerable amount of time. They still want me to fill out more paperwork. They want me to do appointments again. And they want me to start from square one. It's been since 2005 that I got out. They're requesting that I fill more paperwork. So that's where I stand to this day.
My name is Adrienne Kinney. I served on active duty in the United States Army from 1994 to 1998 as an Arabic linguist and military intelligence. I then transferred to the United States Army Reserves, where I served from 1998 to 2004. I was activated and stationed stateside right after 9/11 for about 2 years. And having gone through the system twice, once before 9/11 and the start of the wars and once after, I personally witnessed a complete transformation in the way the process was handled. When I graduated, I eventually got a job at the VA in Richmond, Virginia. And there I was working as a research assistant on a study looking at post-traumatic stress disorder and traumatic brain injury. And I was actually on a conference call when somebody said, "Wait a second, we can't start this screening process. Do you know that if we start screening for traumatic brain injury, there will be tens of thousands of soldiers who will screen positive, and we do not have the resources available that would allow us to take care of these people. So we cannot do the screening." And their rationale was that medical ethics say that if you know somebody has a problem, you have to treat them. So since they didn't have the resources to treat them, they didn't want to know about the problem. The VA needs to address the fact that we have hundreds of thousands of veterans, new veterans, entering a system that has not grown to meet the demands that are being faced by fighting these two occupations. No veteran should have to go without. And not only that, no American should have to go out without health care. I personally believe that the best preventative health care, and this is a day and age where we're all about preventative health care, for our soldiers in uniform is to not use them to fight illegal occupations in the first place. All right. But so long as our government is going to force our soldiers to continue fighting and serving in these occupations, I would call upon all members and employees, workers at the VA to remember our pledge to serve and provide for our returning veterans. And I think that it's so important for them to realize that they do not lose their right of freedom of speech just because they're a federal employee. It is just incumbent upon all VA employees to continue fighting and to fight vocally and long and hard until we have all the resources necessary to take care of our veterans.
My name is Sergeant Christopher Sean Goldsmith. I'm from Belmore, a town in Long Island, New York, 20 minutes out of Manhattan. I could see the smoke when the towers fell on September 11th. I joined the Army to kill people. I signed up as a forward observer. My job was to go out and basically annihilate the enemy when we received contact. I was 19 years old when I was deployed to Iraq. And I spent the first 8 months in Sadr City. The people there hate us. And the reason why is because when we went there, we promised them freedom and we promised them help. We promised to get them clean water, to get them food, to get them jobs. But all that I saw over there now, all that I saw over there in 2005 and all that there is now is 2 to 4 hours of electricity a day, sewage that leaks into their fresh water system, if you want to call it fresh. The water treatment plant, which hasn't been finished, it was barely even worked on the entire year that I was set in Iraq. When I came home from Iraq, all I did was drink. I'm a severe alcoholic, and so was just about everybody who lived in the barracks with me. We used to go out every Friday, Saturday night, and I would have a 1.75 liter bottle of vodka, and I'd just about finish it. And I blacked out every time. That was my goal. I wanted to black out. I was self-medicating. Because we were told that if we were to seek mental health, we would be locked away. and that our careers would not advance. If I admitted that I had severe chronic depression, if I thought I had PTSD or anything like that, my career could have been ruined. The only thing that I had to look forward to was getting out of the military and going to college. I had learned my lesson the hard way, that I should have gone to college, should have got an education, and should never have seen the ugly face of war. And that hope was taken away from me on January 10th, 2007, when George Bush stood in front of Congress and gave his State of the Union address, where he announced that he was going to send an additional 20 to 30,000 troops into the sandbox. And my unit was the 5th Brigade of the 5 to be locked down with stop loss. No one could leave to reenlist, to go somewhere else to avoid the deployment. No one could escape the military. People who were ready to retire, set to retire 2 months from then, were locked into an 18-month deployment under some of the worst conditions since the initial invasion. Those 20 to 30,000 troops that Bush sent over didn't have homes waiting for them. They slept in the dirt. They slept in metal connexes. They slept in houses that had been abandoned. They slept in what they called Al-Qaeda training camps, which is something I want to mention. When I was over there in 2005, I didn't see Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda wasn't there. I was set to deploy the same week that I was set to get out of the Army, according to my contract, and that was in May of 2007. The day before I deployed, was supposed to deploy, Memorial Day, I went out onto a field in Fort Stewart where there's a memoriam, a tree planted for every soldier in the 3rd Infantry Division who has died. I went out among those fallen soldiers and I tried to take my own life. I took pills and I went back to my regular poison of vodka and drank until I couldn't drink anymore. The next thing that I knew, I was handcuffed to a gurney in the hospital. They tried to prosecute me for malingering. I should have the stripes stripped, they should take money from me, possibly put me in jail. And when I went to legal counsel, the military lawyers on Fort Stewart, and I asked for help to fight this Article 15 non-judicial punishment from my commander, they said, no, you need to give up this fight because people try to fight it and all it does is bring down the military and blah, blah, blah. And I was refused help. I was eventually removed from the military on one of the happiest days of my life, August 16th of 2007, on a general discharge. My DD-214, the paperwork which states my entire, every accomplishment of my military service, says in nice big bold letters, misconduct. Serious offense. I committed a serious offense by trying to kill myself because I was so damaged by the war, the occupation in Iraq. So I lost my college benefits. My money is disappearing. Between VA visits and personal instability, I've found it extremely hard to find a job. So I deliver pizzas on Wednesdays. That's what I am now, a pizza delivery boy. I was a sergeant, I was a leader, I was a trainer. I was very well thought of. I was one of the most professional soldiers that I've ever met. And I got the paperwork right here in front of me if anyone ever wants to see it. I was a very good soldier. But now I'm pizza delivery boy who works once a week because that's the only job where I can call in a couple hours before and say, I'm still at the VA, I'm waiting in line. I'm sorry, I can't come in for a couple hours. Major Wesner, Captain Mello, Lieutenant Colonel Adji, First Sergeant Titu, and Sergeant Major Altman, I have one message for you. And that is something that is internationally understood across the world. And that's this. Peace.
You're free, and freedom is beautiful. And, take time to restore chaos and order, but we will.
Gritty, sweet trigger, all out war, simple fire, fight or die, give my life for the core. Situation is raw, shell cases raining down, fighting off insurgents in the North Iraqi town. Back to back, huddle down, struggling for cover, a mission not worth winning, but we fight to save each other. They betrayed our band of brothers, and sent us here to die, and hit behind ideals that their policies deny. We fighting for a lie, as dust fills my eyes, my throat is so dry, my ears are full of cries. The wounded and the dying, screaming agony, in English or in Arabic, it's all the same to me. We're here to make them free, democracy, but the smell of rotten bodies stinks of hypocrisy. It's finally so clear to me, I'm never coming home. Bush will use our bones to build his new throne.
You got your war, what you doing for me? You got your war, tell me who's getting free. You got your war, what's your justification? You ain't building a nation, just inflaming the hatred. You got your war,